Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord.
And also with you.
A very good morning and welcome to you all this fine August Sunday. I take it you're enjoying the weather. It's lovely to be getting a bit of good weather for a change. And it's great that these churches are a bit like fridges, really, when you come into them. So it's a great relief to come into a church like this on such a day. And no surprises, I'll not be wearing robes during these conditions as well. Folks, let me just invite you to stand. There are a few words on screen from Psalm 25 which I'd like us to respond to together before we sing together. Make me to know your ways, O Lord.
Teach me your paths.
Lead me in your truth and teach me.
For you are the God of my salvation.
Do not remember the sins of my youth or my transgressions.
According to your
steadfast
love, remember me, O Lord.
Let me pray as we stand. Lord God, we thank you for this day. We thank you for the life you've given to each one of us. And we thank you that we enjoy the freedom to gather together to worship you without fear or without persecution. So Lord, we thank you for that. And we ask that you're with us. We ask that your Holy Spirit is guiding our hearts and minds this very morning so that we can grow deeper in our faith with you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. I remain standing as we sing our opening hymn, Jesus, my Lord, my God, my all. just a very few announcements to share with you. I'm going to invite Amanda up to speak about our Kids Zone sponsored walk next week. Thanks, Amanda.
Morning, everybody.
Morning.
So next Sunday, Elaine and I start our pre-season training for another year of Kids Zone. So next Sunday we're going to be doing a sponsored walk, and we're going to be walking from Port Rush to Port Stewart. So last year we did from the parish in Portlanoan to over here in Ahochel. So we're spreading our wings a wee bit further this year, and we'll leave Port Rush just before the service of Portlanoan, and hopefully we'll be able to send through a photograph of us having arrived in one piece in Port Stewart before the service finishes here. So this is to raise money for Kids Zone in the coming year. Last couple of years have been very different for us in Kids Zone, so we're hoping, all being well, this year we'll be back to a bit more of normality, able to do a lot more crafts and so on with the kids. And from the money we raised from our walk last year, we were able to go on a fantastic day out in May, and we went to Bangor, and the kids and the adults absolutely loved it, and it was brilliant to be able to do that. So, from what I gather, there's quite a few people are coming along with us next Sunday from Ahochel and Portlanoan, so sorry about that, Dennis. If we could get names by the middle of this week to myself, Elaine, or to Dennis, just so as we can work out the logistics of getting cars at both ends, unless anybody's really keen and wants to do the walk back again, that's fine. And we'd ask if you're doing the walk that you try to raise a few pounds sponsorship for the kids in Kids Zone. And if you're not able to join us on the walk, then any donations of will be gratefully received, and we'll certainly put that money to good use for the kids in Kids Zone. So pray for good weather next week. I'd rather it's a wee bit cooler than it is today. but pray that it's dry and that we have a good day. All right.
Thank you, Amanda.
Oh, sorry.
Go ahead.
And we're going to meet at, I think it's West Strand, that one is, probably about 10 a.m. And we'll finish the walk at Morelli's. And I mean, anybody wants to have an ice cream at that point, I'm sure we'll have earned it.
Thank you,
Amanda. That wee sponsored walk last year was so well supported. It was a real encouragement to our team that both churches got behind it so well. So it was really, really good, and I hope we can do so again this year. And just a reminder, the Kids Zone and the creche are open then from Sunday the 11th of September. So we're leaving it a wee week just so that all the mums and dads get their kids back in the zone as far as school's concerned. So Sunday the 11th of September, spread the word, that is when Kids Zone begins and creche is now open again. One final announcement, just a reminder for select vestry members, if they're here with us today, to stay behind afterwards for a very short wee meeting to discuss an issue. Thank you for that. That's it for our announcements. We take a moment now to remember, as we always do, that we fall short before a holy God. We have made mistakes, and we continue to make mistakes in our life, regardless of how faithfully we try to follow God. So we need to confess that together. So we do that together now, following the words on screen. Lord God, we ask for forgiveness for when we are so quick to criticize others, but then so slow to praise them. For this we ask, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, for when we bear grudges and find it so hard to forgive, Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
For when we alone think we are right and impose our views on others, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
When we let evil go unchallenged and are afraid to speak the truth, for this we say, Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
When we are preoccupied with ourselves all the time and give little attention to others, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
And finally, when we trust in material things more than God's unfailing love, for this we say, Christ, have mercy.
Christ, have mercy.
May Almighty God have mercy upon each one of us. Forgive us our sins and bring us to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Our collect, our special prayer for today, the ninth Sunday after Trinity. Almighty God, who sent your Holy Spirit to be the life and the light of your church, open our hearts to the riches of his grace, that we may bring forth the fruit of the Spirit in love and joy and peace through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Nigel up now to give us our scripture reading from Luke chapter 12.
The reading is from Luke chapter 12, beginning at verse 49. This can be found on page 1046 of the Pew Bibles. Page 1046. I have come to bring fire on the earth, and how I wish it were already kindled. But I have a baptism to undergo, and what constraint I am under until it is completed. Do you think I came to bring peace on earth? No, I tell you, but division. From now on, there will be five in one family divided against each other, three against two, and two against three. They will be divided, father against son, and son against father, mother against daughter, and daughter against mother, mother-in-law against daughter-in-law, and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. He said to the crowd, when you see a cloud rising in the west, immediately you say, it's going to rain, and it does. And when the south wind blows, you say, it's going to be hot, and it is. Hypocrites, you know how to interpret the appearance of the earth and the sky. How is it that you don't know how to interpret this present time? This is the word of the Lord.
Nigel, we're going to stand and sing, worship God again in our next hymn. He will hold me fast. Michael said he's going to change the hymn. I have to change the hymn, so I have to do something else. Well, next thing on the list is the sermon. Sing? No, I'm not going to sing. Some of you might say a sermon's bad enough. Right, we'll just have our sermon now following that scripture, and then we'll sing after that.
Let's take a moment to pray together. Lord God, we thank you again for the freedom and the privilege we enjoy to gather together to worship you. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the truth. We thank you for the challenge that is in it, Lord. We ask that you help us in our hearts and in our minds to really honor you in how we think about you, Lord God. We ask you to help us on our journey, Lord, to follow you. Help us this day, in Jesus' name. Amen. Your light turn off. Well, try to turn off this one.
Just work with us. Is that okay? People hear me okay? Yeah? Yeah, I'll just stick with my mic. Sorry about that. When we follow the lectionary in the Church of Ireland, that is the set of Bible readings that are set every week, there's a massive temptation for me to choose a passage. We always have four passages each Sunday in the lectionary. There's an Old Testament passage, a psalm, a gospel, and an epistle, a New Testament reading. So there's a temptation for me to always have a wee look, have a look at them and check which one's the easiest. I can check which one I know well, and I think, oh, I have a good sermon in my mind for that. Or I can look for the most least complicated one, the one that doesn't require me to explain too much. Or maybe I can just go for the one that's least jarring, okay? That's least more palatable for everyone. And I want you to know that that temptation is always to avoid some passages that seem harsh, that maybe put God in a bad light or put ourselves in a bad light. Maybe they're just a bit negative. So important these days, it seems, that you can say something as long as it's positive. Otherwise, shut up. Otherwise, someone somewhere might be offended. So it can be always better to choose the softer passage in that sense of it. And maybe that would be the thing to do if the Bible were not the Word of God. Maybe that would be the thing to do if we were not concerned about God's truth, about the whole gospel of His Word. I could skirt around certain passages, avoid them, make sure that my preaching is always nice and pink and fluffy and doesn't go far beyond the be good, be nice, try to be a better person. If that's not going well, go to God because He'll forgive you. God forgives. If I stuck to that sort of message and avoided anything that was sticky in the Bible, I can assure you, for one, I would be selling you short. If that's the depth of the teaching that you ever receive, and then you step out into the world and life happens to you, then you will be snookered. And you certainly won't go back to His Word for help. Jesus says in this passage, and it's on page 10 or 1046, if you want to have it in front of you, He says, I came to cast fire on the earth and would that it already be kindled. What is He talking about here? What is He saying? He then goes on to say, do you think I have come to give peace on earth? No, I tell you, but rather division. What? Jesus, are you not the Prince of Peace? You're not the Prince of Division. So challenging. Now, if we just have a quick read through of this and then just carry on and avoid it, if we have a quick read through, we just think that Jesus has come to bring destruction and He's come to bring war, not peace. And He even wants our families to fall out, it seems, to be divided. As always, context gives us a different picture. The context for this passage in Luke 12 is the final judgment. And again, that's another topic that some might think is just unsuitable for a pleasant Sunday afternoon in a local church of Ireland. But no, it's the truth of God's word. But in Luke 12, earlier, he talks about Jesus, the parable of the rich fool. And that was a warning to someone who spent their whole life on their little kingdom, making sure they had enough money for themselves and their family, maybe, and also for retirement. And that person was so focused on all that, whenever their lives were required of them, as the way it's put, they were found wanting. They did not genuinely seek God or be generous to God throughout their lives. And later in Luke 12, we have another instruction from Jesus to be ready for Christ's return. Like the servants waiting for the master to return, they need to be ready and to be found in God's service and not otherwise occupied. So this context for this passage is judgment. It is Jesus' return. It's our readiness for His return. And judgment is what Jesus is to and will bring. And it seems that He is keen on it, urgent even. I came to cast fire on the earth, and would that it already be kindled. That's really challenging. This fire that we talk about in Scripture, it's in Isaiah and Malachi. It's often used to refer to the judgment day, the end. And it is a refining fire. It's actually a positive thing because it comes to keep and maintain and purify the good and then burn away all the impurities. It's a refining fire. So it's judgment that Jesus is talking about, and I'm going to come back to that. Let's first think about this notion, first, that Jesus has not come to bring peace, but division. World peace is something that we all would love, isn't that right? We all like the sound of that. Whenever there's a Miss World contest, all the contestants seem to say that that's what they want most when they're interviewed. They just want world peace. But we know, Christian or not, that the people of this world are already pretty good at division. Across the world, across the history of time, that has been the norm. And that is man. We're pretty good at arguing and conflict. Peace, though it is desired by many, is really quite rare. There's hardly a country in history, especially if they're bordered with someone, who has not known war and conflict. And even in modern developed Europe today, here again we are, Ukraine and Russia. Jesus is saying here that he didn't come to fix all that in terms of getting us all together for a big hug and peace will ensue. Jesus came to impact individuals. Jesus came to impact individuals. He is the Prince of Peace in the sense that when you go to him and know forgiveness, you have peace with God. And alongside fellow believers, you can be who are also aware of their need for Jesus, you have peace and you have that with your fellow man, and it's a real thing. But in this world, with those who are not aware of their need for him, there will not be peace, Jesus says. Conflict will be the norm. I've heard it said that Jesus is like a magnet. You know the way each magnet has a north and south pole. So depending on which side, a bit of metal will be pushed away or drawn to it. The hearts of man and woman respond to Jesus in this way. We're either attracted to him or we are repelled somehow. And in that is division. Can you see? Jesus doesn't come to the world as one mass and declare war. He comes to the individual and he changes the person for the good, and then they change. But in this world that Jesus is so keen for judgment to be brought to, by the way, because so many have turned away from God, I'm sure, and they're doing it their own way. But in this world, those who find Jesus, those who seek the kingdom of God and want then to do life his way, God's way, will, as a matter of fact, be against, be divided from those who continue to want to do it their own way. A person won over to God, at peace with God through the work of Jesus on the cross, should be living for God. And that will be in contrast to the world around them. Those who are unconverted, those who are living for themselves. And it's not because, important point here, it's not because Jesus and his followers are to actively seek and create discord or disunity. We're supposed to seek the opposite. We're supposed to seek peace and unity amongst our brothers and sisters. It's because they are changed as individuals. They're changed for the good. They're living in the light. And then they stand out. And those around them who witness this change are, to put it in polite society, uncomfortable. In reality, they're upset and aggravated and against it. Jesus gives the example of family being put against each other. I think he's trying to tell us that is just really, that's going to be the closest and most intimate relationships that are often most difficult when someone makes a commitment to follow him. Obviously, we don't want this for our family. We want our family to be a Christian family and a united family. But in all likelihood, if a person who is taking Jesus seriously, and I mean living for him, with him, you're taking Jesus seriously and you're alongside someone who is not, then that can and does lead to division, disunity. It's not that Jesus desires this, it's just a natural outcome. Again, we don't want that. As a Christian father, any Christian father will want his wife and his children to be on the same page. Isn't that right? A Christian mother will be careful to ensure her children are taught and brought up in the faith and told about Jesus in the home, not just on Sunday. A son or a daughter who becomes a Christian for real will often cause some division in the household. I came to my mum and dad 15 or 16 years ago. Mum, Dad, I'm a Christian. What do you mean? He said, does that mean you're going to church? It means I believe in Jesus Christ. I mean, really, truly believe in him. My life's turned upside down. For the first time in my life, I know this peace. I know forgiveness. I have a right relationship with the living Lord. I feel free to follow him and serve him. Mom said, okay. Dad leaned over in a quiet moment and said, just as long as you don't take it too seriously, Dennis. Sorry, Dad. I had to point out that if I was going to do this at all, I would only be doing it seriously. There's no point otherwise. My dad just didn't want me to embarrass myself or the family by becoming some religious nut or wearing one of these. In other parts of the world, this is a tame thing. Parts of the world that we might think are less civilized than us, but in reality, maybe not. There's other parts of the world where the cost of revealing yourself as a follower of Christ might, of course, be far more severe. It might cost you your life. Your family might hand you over to the authorities, and if you're in Asia, you might be completely disowned by your family and the Arab community. We were at Kingdom Voices this week here, and there was many bishops from all over the world visiting. They were at Lambeth, and then they were with us for a week in Ireland. And every bishop, every country was represented, has a horrendous story, many horrendous stories among their fellowships, among their communities, of parishioners coming to faith and finding Jesus and paying for it with their lives. Christianity, if you're aware of your own need of forgiveness and you realize that that forgiveness is available through Jesus, that'll change you as an individual. And as that change is made, others will see it. Verse 50, Jesus says, I have a baptism to be baptized with, and how great is my distress until it is accomplished. Jesus is saying judgment is coming, and he seems to be saying sooner rather than later, this world is in such a state. But first, I have a baptism to go through. My own fire baptism, as Jesus would say, and that is on the cross. And his distress is so great about this. Judgment is coming for you all, but first I will go to the cross, and then the word will be divided. Then the opportunity for forgiveness and righteousness before God is there, but the world will be divided amongst those who choose to follow me, Jesus, and the one who choose to reject me. Christianity, if you're aware of your own need of forgiveness and you realize that that forgiveness is available through Jesus, will bring peace into your life. It will bring you peace with God. And it should bring you peace with your fellow Christian if you are alongside them, keeping your eyes on God. You see how great a leveler it is, actually. When two people who might be from totally different backgrounds, led totally different lives, when they both know that they need Jesus, they need his forgiveness to be right with God, then that's a unifying thing. They're on the same page. They have that in common. They both need that. Following Jesus, making an individual commitment to follow him in this life, recognizing your need for him, will cause unity among your fellow brothers and sisters because you're on the same page. You need Jesus. Maybe we have people in our own family who giggle at the idea that we even go near a church. That might happen. Maybe they get riled at the mention of God or Jesus or talking about prayer too much in the home. Or maybe we have members of our family that just leave us to it, pay lip service. That turns you on, that's okay. Jen and I would talk on occasion, and we have friends who have definitely cooled in their friendships towards us because since we have been striving to live the Christian life. And sometimes there's also direct challenge in there. There's confrontation, especially if you start using Jesus' language, talk about, even begin to warn them that the stakes are high, that there's a cost to not knowing him, that there's a cost to not choosing him, and that is separation from him. I think people, by the way, get stirred up and get riled about the Christian faith because deep down on some levels, there's something going on. I think the people who would call themselves unbelievers actually know truth in their hearts. Romans does talk about them suppressing the truth. I think deep down people know that they themselves are a miracle, that they're walking and breathing at all, and this world is a miracle, and there must be a God and a creator. I think they know that deep down. I think they know deep down that there must be something after this world. They know, and they're frightened, that death is all there is. I think they know deep down they're made for more. And I think they know also that justice is a right thing. That people who have done wrong and do wrong deserve it. I think it's that truth deep down in their hearts, that recognition actually, that causes most of the venom against Christianity. And Jesus warns again in this passage that the judgment, justice is coming, and the signs are so clear. Is it not the case, and I promise, I don't want to sound like a doom merchant or gloom merchant here, but is it not the case that most people you talk to, maybe these words have come out of your mouth yourselves or someone in your family, but most people in this world at this time are saying things like, has this world not gone completely mad? Tell me you haven't heard that. I have a feeling person upon person, country upon country, tribe upon tribe are saying to themselves at this moment in time, this world's going crazy. Does it not all feel like it's all ramping up? It's not going in a good direction. I promise I'm trying not to be a gloom merchant. A Christian is supposed to be positive and supposed to be looking for God at work in this world and looking for good and building upon it and building relationships. But the Christian, with everyone else in the world, I think sees that a lot is not going in the right direction. Think about the environment for 5 minutes. Global warming, flooding. Think about technology, how it is, yes, something to embrace, but also something that is dividing us and making us individualistic. And people are losing jobs because of technology advancements. People's mental health, think about that for a moment. Think about loneliness. Think about world wars. Think about the gap between the rich and poor. Have a moan about the NHS. So much is going in the wrong direction. Jesus says, you lot, you're good at reading the signs. Jesus says, you see a cloud coming in the distance and you're fit to say, oh, rain's coming. Stick the coats on. Let's not bother with that walk. Any excuse for me? Or there's a south wind blowing, Jesus says, and a warm wind is coming. Well, that's going to be a warm day ahead. Jesus says, you're good at that. But why do you not know how to interpret the present time? People, in spite of all our technological developments, in spite of how clever we all are, people are still not, or continuing not to treat each other well. People are continuing to take advantage of each other across the world. Injustice continues to be rife. If you turn on the news for 5 minutes, you'll get an injustice story after another injustice story after another injustice story. And then you'll get the football. And sometimes there's injustice there. But not yesterday. Injustice continues to be rife in this world. If there's a sign that's there that Jesus wants you to help you pick up, help you recognize, injustice is rife. We're told, we're trained as Christians when we read God's word to fight against injustice. We're supposed to love justice as God does. But Jesus says, look at the signs. Injustice is rife. Jesus says, God is coming. He has had, or he will have had enough at some point, and he's coming to make all things right. And again, that's a good making things right. The good will be purified, and the evil, the dross, will be burnt away. And good news, Jesus says he's already went through a baptism of fire for us all. And that's the cross. So that we know forgiveness for many injustices we have added to the weight. And we are made right with God. We are righteous before God. What wonderful news. What a wonderful thing Jesus has done for us in the midst of this truth. Jesus asks, follow or don't. If you follow, there will be difficulties. It will not be easy. But hold on. He will return. Let us pray. Lord, we thank you for your word. In spite of the difficulties, in spite of the challenges that it brings up within us, Lord, we are so programmed to be positive and to be all about peace that we are challenged by this word. But we recognize, Lord God, that you are good and you are holy, that your will is perfect. And so, Lord, we hear your word and we accept it. So, Lord, help us as individuals make that individual acceptance of you. And help us change through your Holy Spirit. Help us shine out to those around us, Lord. Help us be examples of peace and justice in this world. And may we hang on to you, Lord, as we strive to follow you. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Choose after that. Still saying, he will hold me fast. Well, that's what we maybe need to hear too. Now we're going to stand and sing our next hymn, He Will Hold Me Fast.
Thank you.
standing there as we affirm our faith together. Jack, you can bring those slides on. Let us declare our faith in God. We say together, we believe.
We believe in God the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth is named. We believe in God the Son, who lives in our hearts through faith and fills us with his love. We believe in God the Holy Spirit, who strengthens us with power from on high. We believe in one God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.
Please be seated. Take a moment now to pray together, and our response to the Lord in your mercy is hear our prayer. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Our Father in heaven, we pray for all people in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, we pray for the church. We pray for our own Bishop, Bishop George, and all who lead and teach and minister in Christ's name. Pray for all bishops and clergy throughout this world. We ask, Lord, that you encourage them to hold up your name, to hold on to the truth of your word. Give them steadfastness, Lord, give them grace when they need it most. Lord, grant that we may be nourished in our faith and understanding, and help us to bear daily witness to Christ's love in our lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for the nations of the world and for all those who take authority to serve in the cause of justice and human well-being. We pray for leadership throughout the world. We pray that you can rise up godly leaders. We ask, Lord, that you strengthen our Queen and the leaders of all the nations, give them the gifts of wisdom, courage, and integrity, so that your will may be done on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for those who are afflicted by natural disasters or caught up in brutal conflicts throughout the world. Lord, as I mentioned, the news can be so overwhelming when we see the conflict that is present throughout this globe. We ask, Lord, that you can bring hope, that you can change individuals. We ask, Lord, that you fill people with the resurrection hope that good will prevail, and bless all who stand with them in finding solutions to their difficulties. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for the people we are called to serve in the home, in our neighborhood, in our communities, and at work. Help us, Lord, to reflect you better to those around us. Help us to show love and compassion. Help us to be about unity. Help us to work hard at building good relationships and to strive for reconciliation when they break down. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, we pray for all who suffer illness or loneliness or weakness, and we take a moment in silence now, Lord, to bring before you those who are on our hearts and who are in need of your healing hand. Healing, you know those whom we have named in our hearts perfectly, and you know their needs perfectly. We pray that You provide for them as is your will. Raise them from despair to hopefulness and health. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we remember with thanksgiving those who have died. We pray in particular today for Port Glenoan Monastery following the death of Father Martin. Be with them and strengthen them. And we ask, Lord, that you strengthen all who mourn with the sure hope that in Christ their loved ones are raised to fullness of life. Lord, in your mercy. And we ask that you accept these, our prayers, for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ. Amen. And we pray together also the prayer that our Saviour Christ taught us, the Lord's Prayer, beginning, Our Father, who art in heaven. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen. We'll stand to sing again. We'll sing our closing hymn now. Be to the Lord a glad you saw. Is that right? Yep. Let's pray. Lord God, Father in heaven, we thank you again for this day. We ask that you guide us, Lord, as we leave this building. Help us to seek you deeper in our lives. Help us to live our lives for you. And may we shine out to others, Lord, as we do. We ask this in Jesus' name.
Amen.
God bless you. I hope you keep well. I hope to see most of you next week at least. And keep safe. Go in peace, to love, and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ. Amen.